Hey folks, welcome to Digimento Education. This is Analog Circuits Lecture 3. Hopefully you must have gone through the last two lectures in which I covered the introduction to analog electronics and introduction to half-wave rectifiers. You must be well versed with the concepts that I covered in the last two lectures because they are very important with respect to gate and IES. Please hit the like button, share and subscribe to our channel and write down your comments below. If you like this video, please do like this video. Please hit the like button and share and subscribe to our channel for the latest updates. Now, let's start with the first topic of discussion in this lecture was the 15th topic of half-wave rectifier. We are going to discuss frequency of the output. Okay, now frequency of the output. Now frequency of the output is basically same as that of input, that is the AC supply, and have the same time period. Okay, this is important to note down, that frequency of the output is the same as of input, which was your AC signal. Input was your AC signal, and have the same time periods. Okay, now so as the output is non-sinusoidal, it has harmonics present. Okay, when you basically apply a Fourier series expansion of the signal, of the output signal, you will get multiple frequencies present. Okay, and can be known from Fourier series expansion, and can easily be known with Fourier series expansion. Okay, so we can say that the output voltage is equal to VO is equal to Vm by pi Vm by 2 sine omega naught t minus 2 Vm by pi summation k only for even values cos k omega naught t upon k plus 1 k minus 1. This is how you represent the output voltage. This is the Fourier series expansion of the output voltage. It's not that important, but it's important to note down that the fundamental frequency of the half rectifier is omega naught. So basically the output has the frequency of omega naught, same as that of the input frequency of the input signal. So this part is DC and this part is AC, so we can say it's a combination of both DC and AC. Understood? So from here you can say the output of half wave rectifier has fundamental frequency of omega naught or F naught. Okay, so it's important to note down that fundamental frequency is equal to omega naught. This is important. Okay, it's omega naught. Now, or another name of fundamental frequency is basically ripple frequency. Ripple frequency is also omega naught. Both are same in this case. Okay, let's move to the 15th point of discussion. I know there are a hell lot of subtopics in half wave rectifier to remember, but it's important. You cannot do anything about that. 15th point is angle of conduction. angle of conduction. Angle of conduction basically refers to the period for which your diode conducts. The period for which your diode conducts. So you can define it as, it is the duration, it is the duration for which diode conducts in a rectifier. Okay, so if the diode is ideal in the sense V gamma cut-in voltage is equal to zero, we do not consider either of cut-in voltage and forward diode resistance in case of ideal diode. Okay, so in case of ideal diode, so you won't require a minimum of cut-in voltage to turn on the diode for turn on an ideal diode. Okay, so we do not require even the minimum voltage to turn it on, because it acts as a switch. An ideal diode acts as a switch. So if the diode is ideal, then conduction angle is from 0 to pi. That is, conduction angle becomes angle becomes 180 degree. For non-ideal diode, ideal diode for which V gamma is not equal to zero, if we just have a look at the input voltage, you can see it's varying like this. Okay, and this voltage is basically your minimum voltage required to turn your diode on. Okay, so you require minimum of this particular voltage. This angle is theta. This angle will be 180 minus theta. Okay, so conduction angle lies between theta and 180 minus theta. So your conduction angle is 180 minus 2 theta. Okay, this is 180 minus theta. Minus theta is 180 minus 2 theta is the conduction angle. How would you be able to find out theta? Now, this is basically sine omega. So in this case, we can say Vm sine alpha or theta. At what angle Vm sine alpha is equal to V gamma? Or you can say it's a theta. So we have written theta, so write just theta here. So we can say sine theta is V gamma by Vm. Theta is sine inverse V gamma by Vm. So this is the conduction angle. If you are given the value of the cut-in voltage and Vm, we can easily find out the conduction angle theta, which is theta. And the conduction angle would become 180 minus 2 theta. Understood? So in this case, we can say since V gamma is very, very less than Vm, theta will be very small. Okay, V gamma is order of the 0.7 volts or 0.3 volts, as we already studied in electronic devices and circuits for silicon and germanium respectively, or angle of conduction will be slightly less than 180 degrees. Understood? This is how it goes. The another point of discussion which is not asked in gate examination, it's only meant for IES. Okay, but you can never trust IIT people sitting there. Okay, IIT professor sitting there, and they may test you on anything they would like to test you on. Okay, so the next one is transformer utilization factor. Which is also known as TUF. It's not for gate, it's only for IS, but I would suggest you to do it for gate as well. It's just only one formula that you need to remember and understand the basics behind it. Okay, it's not a big deal. So what is a TUF? TUF basically refers to it, basically it is the ratio of DC output power to AC rating of secondary winding. Okay, it's a DC is basically the AC power rating of the secondary winding. What was your efficiency? Efficiency was DC output power upon input AC power, which was IRMS square into RF plus RL. And output power was IDC square into RL upon IRMS square into RF plus RL. Now this is basically ratio of DC output power to AC power rating of the secondary winding. Okay, power rating. So basically AC rating is basically the product of RMS voltage across the secondary winding and RMS current through secondary winding. Okay, it is expressed in volt ampere. So TUF is basically PDC over AC power rating of secondary winding. Okay, so this would become IDC square into RL by VM by root 2 into IM by 2, because input voltage at the secondary winding is an AC voltage, and but the current flowing through it is basically half wave rectified, and this would become IM by 2. This is RMS value will be equal to IM by 2. So this will become IM by pi whole square into RL divided by IM square into RF plus RL divided by 2 root 2. Okay, this would become 2 root 2 RL divided by pi square RF plus RL. And transformer utilization factor then becomes, if you solve for the 2 root 2, it comes 0.286 RL by RF plus RL. Okay, this is a TUF factor or the TUF factor for half wave rectifier. So when RF is equal to 0 for ideal case, ideal diode, we get TUF maximum value being 0.286. Okay, it's not that important, but it's important for IES. Okay, now let's have a look at an example. Okay, let's have a look at that. Just change the color. Now look at this question. The half wave rectifier uses 5:1 transformer and a diode with internal resistance of 10 ohms. This is RF. Okay, if the primary voltage is 220 volt RMS, this is the input secondary voltage. So basically the input voltage on the primary winding, and 50 hertz, and load resistance is 500 ohm. So this is RL value. This is RL. Calculate the DC load current and voltage, AC load current, average diode voltage and current, and PIV and ripple frequency. let's go step by step. So what are we available with? RF is 10 ohm and RL being a 500 ohm, and the turns ratio N1 is to N2 is 5:1. So since we know N1 is to N2 is 5:1, so we can say that VI RMS at the secondary winding, this voltage at the secondary winding will be equal to 220/5 is equal to 44 VRMS. Understood? This is at the secondary winding. Okay. Now, RMS secondary voltage, what would that be? What would that be? It would be equal to Vm by root 2. So this will be equal to Vm by root 2. So from here, we can calculate Vm value. Okay. So we can calculate Vm maximum value 44 into root 2. Okay, which is nothing but 62.2 volts. It's a maximum input voltage. We can calculate Im from here is Vm by RF plus RL, as we saw in the derivations earlier. So it will be equal to Vm by RF plus RL. This is 62.2 RF. Now we know RF is 10 plus RL is 500. Then it is equal to 122 milliampere. You should not be jeopardized by the calculations, because you shall be available with the calculator. So start practicing the gate calculator from today onwards. As soon as you watch this video, be well versed with the calculator and all the parts of it, how to use it. Okay, there are many lectures available. We shall also provide the lecture to how to efficiently use the calculator in the examination, okay, so as to save your time. Now let's have a look at the A part. They're asking for the DC load current and voltage. Okay, DC load current. Now we know that DC load current is equal to Im by pi. This is the current which is flowing in the circuit. Now we know Im is 122 divided by pi, and it comes out to be 38.8 milliampere. Okay, now VDC is IDC into RL. We can use this formula. IDC is 38.8 into RL. Now RL is 0.5. Okay, this would turn out to be 19.4 volts. 500 ohm is 0.5 kilo ohm. Okay, we have taken 38.8 milliampere. So in order to counter that, we have to use 0.5 kilo ohm in order to simplify the calculations. Otherwise, you have to separately consider 10 to the power minus 3 and 10 to the power 3. So in order to make your work less tedious and less cumbersome, you have to take the counterparts, the units with their counterparts also in the expression, so that the calculations become easy. Now, this was for the first part. Now let's see what is your B part saying. B part is asking to find out AC load current. AC load current. So AC load is pure AC component. It's asking for the pure AC component. So AC output current is equal to, which is also equal to IRMS prime. Okay. IRMS dash is nothing but ripple factor into IDC. Because we know ripple factor is basically equal to IRMS dash by IDC. And we know the ripple factor, or the ripple factor for the half wave rectifier, is 1.21 into IDC. We just calculated. What is IDC? Is 38.8 milliampere. And this comes out to be 46.9 milliampere. You can also find it out using this particular formula. There's no harm in that. IRMS square minus IDC square. That's it. We know IRMS will be equal to Im by 2, and IDC is Im by pi. If you solve that thing, plug in the values, you will again get the same value. Okay, there's no harm. So now what is, now asking the average diode voltage and current. Average diode voltage. So C portion will be average diode voltage. We know average diode voltage is minus Vm by pi. So this will be minus Vm. Vm we just calculated. Vm is 62.2. We have just calculated 62.2 divided by pi, and this would turn out to be -19.8 volts. Now, average diode current. So, basically, I didn't tell you about the average diode current. Okay. So, it is quite tacit that average diode current will be equal to Im by pi or IDC, because this is the current which is flowing in the circuit. This is the net current which is flowing in the circuit, and that current is also flowing through the diode, and that would be also that is also equal to a DC current. That's why the average diode current is Im by pi or IDC, which is equal to 38.8 milliampere. Understood? Now let's have a look at the D part of the question. What is it asking? It's asking for PIV and ripple frequency. Now what is PIV for a Harvey rectifier is equal to? Vm, that's a magnitude value, is 62.2 volts, and ripple frequency or the fundamental frequency are both same, omega naught, or since we're writing in hertz, so we should write f naught is 50 hertz. Okay, this is how it goes. This is how you basically have to you will encounter this is the type of questions which you encounter in the gate examination. Okay, now is the time to begin our discussion on another type of rectifier, which is also another more customized rectifier and more sophisticated rectifier, is a center tapped full wave rectifier. A center tapped full wave rectifier. A center tapped full wave rectifier is very, very important. Now, let me quickly draw how a full wave rectifier looks. A center tapped full wave rectifier looks. So, this is basically your AC supply. This is basically AC supply. Okay. This is basically again a transformer. It's a step down transformer. Okay. It's a step down transformer. Now, a full wave rectifier basically incorporates, a center tapped full wave rectifier incorporates two diodes, then one diode in the half wave rectifier. Okay. Center tapped means this portion is grounded. Okay. And we have a load resistance RL, and we take the output here. Okay. So this is basically node A. This is basically node B. This is D1 and this is D2 diode. This is how you denote, this is how you draw a full wave rectifier. This portion will again be an AC source. Okay, this is the AC supply. The current will be a DC. Now let's write some of the points related to a full wave rectifier. So in this case, secondary winding is divided into two halves. Okay. If primary winding has N1 turns, then each half of secondary winding has N2 turns. Okay, I have written N2 here. It doesn't mean that it will be equal to N2/2 and this is equal to N2/2. No, this hole each has N2 turns. Each has N2 turns. Okay, it's not, you should not get confused with this. It is not N2/2 and N2/2, it's N2 and N2. Okay, you should be clear with this, otherwise this will you will end up in getting wrong results. Okay, so be careful with that. secondary, each turn has secondary winding. So if the center terminal is grounded, if the center terminal is grounded, then voltages VA and VB are equal in magnitude but opposite in polarity, which implies VA is equal to minus VB. It's always, it will always be true. It will always be true. This is plus minus, this will be plus and minus. You can say VA and VB are always opposite in polarity. So you can say if VA is plus VM sine alpha, then VB will be equal to minus VM sine alpha. Now, let me quickly explain you the operation of this thing, of a full wave rectifier. Okay, so let's discuss the two different cases following this discussion. So first is when alpha lies between 0 and pi. When alpha lies between 0 and pi. Now, when alpha lies between 0 and pi, your VA will be positive, and you can say VB is basically taking a minus 180 degree phase shift with respect to VA. So in this case, VA is positive and VB is negative. Now, since VA is positive, if VA is positive, this diode D1 will be forward biased. D1 is forward biased, which is short circuited, and D2 is reverse biased, which is open circuited, which means that the conduction will be like this. Okay, the conduction will be like this. The conduction will be like this. So if you just quickly see how it looks, so the conduction will be like this. So conduction will be like this. The conduction is going to be like this. So your output will follow VA. So output follows VA. So output follows VA. So you can say VO will be equal to VA. So as a result, you will have your output voltage as this. The amplitude is again VM. VM, this amplitude is also VM. Now, let's have a look at the second case. When alpha varies between pi and 2 pi. Second case, when alpha lies between pi and 2 pi. For this particular case, your VA is negative and VB is positive. VA is negative and VB is positive, which means that diode D1 is reverse biased, diode D2 is forward biased. This will be open circuited, and this will be short circuited. So your output follows VB. So if we have a look at this circuit, this will be open circuited, this will be short circuited, this will be center tab, and this is VB. This is diode D2, diode D1, so it will conduct like this. Okay, so output VO will be equal to VB. So from here, if we just have a look at this diagram, it will be like this. So it keeps on going like this for every interval. So half wave rectified, this is full wave rectified signal. This is full wave rectified. Since it is non-sinusoidal, it will have harmonics present. Okay, so in this case, the fundamental frequency, you can clearly observe that it has doubled with respect to the input frequency. Okay, if the input frequency was 50 hertz, it will be doubled, that will be equal to 100 hertz. That we shall discuss in the later part of this course. Okay. So it's basically a combination of two half-wave rectifiers. So you can say full-wave rectifier is a combination of two half-wave rectifiers. Okay. Now let's quickly perform the analysis part of this. So I'm not going to describe everything again, as you already know about the descriptions, and you know already know the descriptions in the from the half-wave rectifier discussion. So I'm just quickly writing what are the changes and what are the formulas when we perform the analysis of the full wave rectifier. Okay, so first one will be instantaneous output current. Instantaneous output current. So for when alpha lies between 0 and pi, your diode is forward biased. Diode D is forward biased. D1 is forward biased. And we can replace it with, if we consider RF only of the diode D1. So if we apply the KVL in the first circuit, if we replace it by RF, if we apply the KVL in the first circuit, we get, so KVL in first loop, we get minus VA plus IRF plus IRL is equal to 0. We get I as VA by RL plus RF is equal to Vm sin alpha over RF plus RL, and is equal to Im sin alpha. Okay, where Im is equal to Vm by RF plus RL. Okay, and when your alpha lies between pi and 2 pi, we get diode D2 is forward biased, and we can replace it with RF. So if we just apply the KVL in the other loop, we get minus VB plus IRF plus IRL is equal to 0. I is equal to VB by RF plus RL. VB is minus VM sin alpha over RF plus RL. We get I as minus IM sin alpha. So from here we can conclude that I will be equal to IM sin alpha when alpha varies between 0 and pi, and minus IM sin alpha when it varies between pi and 2 pi. Understood? Okay, this is a peak output current. You can say peak output current. Now, second topic of discussion is DC output current. You know the definition, so I'm not going to write it again. DC output current will be equal to IDC 1 upon 2 pi integration 0 to 2 pi I d alpha. Let's plug these values in for the particular for each interval. We get IDC as 2 Im by pi. It will be equal to 2 Im by pi. Okay, so you can say that the DC current in the output is based, the average current in the output or across RL is double to that in the case of half-wave rectifier. Okay, now third topic of discussion is RMS output current. RMS output current. So if you just have a look at the formula, so you know how to calculate IRMS. IRMS, this is the total RMS current. It's not pure AC output current, okay, that's basically the total RMS current, okay, this will be equal to square root of 1 upon 2 pi 0 to 2 pi I square d alpha. This comes out to be Im by root 2, okay, this will be equal to Im by root 2. This is Im by root 2. Now you must be confused that for a sinusoidal signal and for a half-wave rectifier signal, we also get the same values. Remember this thing. The DC current IDC for this is equal to 0. IDC for the sinusoidal signal is equal to 0. The DC, if I is like this, a pure sinusoidal curve, the DC value will be equal to 0 because this area will cancel this area. But in general, we take the period only for this particular, we only take this particular interval, okay, for two separate intervals. We get 2 Im by pi and the other one we get is minus 2 Im by pi. If we add both, we get 0 because 2 Im by pi minus 2 Im by pi is equal to 0. And also for this, it is also equal to, you can see that it is also equal to 2 Im by pi. So, this is the RMS output current, which is equal to Im by root 2. The fourth topic of discussion is, fourth one is RMS value of pure AC component. Again, I'm going to write the direct formula. The pure AC component has the formula to calculate I RMS prime is equal to square root of I RMS square minus IDC square. There's no change in the formula. It remains the same for both. We have then ripple factor. Okay, fifth one is ripple factor. Ripple factor, we have it for ripple factor, we know basically denotes the variations in the output DC voltage that we get, okay, so it's basically equal to I RMS prime upon IDC, okay, so this is also equal to square root of F square minus 1, and this will be equal to IRMS by IDC whole square minus 1. We get square root of IRMS is Im by is equal to Im by root 2 upon 2 Im by pi whole square minus 1. We get it as 0.483. Now if we compare it with the half-wave rectifier, it was 1.21. Now here it is 0.483. You can see that there is a very drastic decrease in the ripple factor on the ripples in the output DC voltage. That's a very good sign. We are on the right track to get a pure DC output. Okay. So we would prefer the full wave rectifier over half wave rectifier. But there are many limitations that we shall discuss later. Okay. Now input average power. The next topic of discussion is input average power, which is sixth point, is input power. Input power is denoted by PI, is basically the average value of the product of instantaneous input voltage and instantaneous input current. So we get PI, again it will remain the same, IRMS square into RF plus RL. Okay, it's going to remain the same. Then we have seventh topic, we have efficiency. We have efficiency, which we denote by eta, the percentage efficiency, which is denoted by eta, is output DC power upon input power into 100%. Okay, this will be equal to IDC square into RL divided by IRMS square into RF plus RL into 100%. This will be equal to 4 Im square by pi square into RL divided by Im square by 2 into RF plus RL into 100%. If you solve for this, you get it as 81 into RL by RF plus RL percentage. So percentage efficiency has now increased, has now just doubled. You can see it's 81 RL by RF plus RL percentage. This is the percentage efficiency of full wave rectifier, center tapped. So maximum efficiency is when RF is equal to 0, which is for the ideal diode case, is equal to 81%. In a half wave rectifier, it was 40.5%. It has just now doubled. Okay. Now, output DC voltage. We have then output DC voltage, which is the 8th part. Output diode voltage, sorry. Let me just make a correction here. This is not what I am supposed to write. Now, we are going to discuss now. 8th one is a diode DC voltage. Diode DC voltage, or the average DC voltage, whatever you call it. Both are same. So we have, so in this case, consider diode D1. Consider the diode. Okay, consider diode D1 when alpha lies between 0 and pi. Okay, diode D1 is forward biased. So we can say that V diode is equal to 0. We are not considering RF value here. We are considering the ideal case. We are considering it to be ideal. Okay. So V diode will be nearly equal to 0. You can say it's a nearly equal to 0 because RF is also very small value. Okay. For the other interval, when alpha is between 0 to, despite say 2 pi, diode D1 is reverse biased. Now, if we have a look at this particular case, this diode D1 will be reverse biased. So there is no current flowing in the circuit. We are considering to be an ideal diode. This will be short circuited. Okay. So this will be short circuited because resistance will be offered will be equal to 0. And so we are going to consider this particular case. This is basically V diode. If we are considering, we are doing it for only diode D1. We are considering it for diode D1. And that would also be applicable to diode D2. Okay. This is center tab. This is plus. This is minus. And this is voltage VA. This is voltage VB. For this particular case, you can say that diode D1 will be reverse biased and diode D2 will be forward biased. We can say this potential drop is VAB. Okay, if we apply the KVL in this case, so KVL in the loop, KVL by on applying the KVL in the loop, we get plus minus, which is plus VAB, plus VAB minus V diode is equal to 0. So you can say V diode will be equal to VAB. Okay, and this will be equal to VA minus VB. What is VA? It is VM sine alpha minus. What is VB? Is minus VM sine alpha. So we get V diode as 2 VM sine alpha. This is this has got hell lot of importance. You should not forget this. Okay, so thus we can conclude. Thus, we can conclude that V diode will be negligible. You can say it's nearly equal to 0 it will be a very small value because RF is very, very small and we are not considering RF right now. We are considering to be an ideal case. V diode will be equal to 0 for the interval 0 and pi, and this would be equal to 2Vm sine alpha for the interval pi to 2 pi. This is very, very important. Okay, and from here we can calculate that V diode DC value, V diode DC value using the formula 0 to 2 pi V diode D alpha. With the help of this, we get DC value as minus 2 Vm by pi. We get minus 2 Vm by pi. This is basically applicable to both D1 and D2 diodes. Okay, we have performed the analysis of D1 diode, but this doesn't mean that this will not be applicable to D2 diode. This is also applicable to D2 diode. So, okay folks, I am stopping this lecture here. Please go through the lecture very carefully and try to understand each and every nuance of the lecture that I covered, of all the topics that I covered and marked separately as important. And I would request you to please like this video. If you really like the video, please hit the like button. Subscribe to our channel Digimento Education and hit the bell icon for the latest updates, because we want that you guys never miss out any update from us. So that's why it is your responsibility to hit the like button and subscribe to our channel. Please give a thumbs up to this video if you really like it, and also mention your write down the comments in the comment section below. Okay, if you have any doubt, please write those queries under that. We would really help you out. Thank you very much.